obviously, this podcast, it is not a cable news show. I didn't bring you here to like have a shouting match with you. That's not how we operate. And so I want to be fair and give you as much opportunity to put your point of view as forward as possible. And then I will be obviously critiquing some of the things that I found in the book.
Sure.
I think the overall themes are some of the areas where I had the biggest issues. Mm-hmm. This book reads to me like a convert's zeal to enact retribution against the people you previously aligned with. Mm-hmm. That's probably harsh, but that's how it came across to me. And it's not that I don't think there's any legitimate criticisms of the industry or the gun rights movement or the NRA. Obviously, I've been at the forefront of reporting on some of the corruption inside of the NRA itself. And I don't think there's probably areas that we would have some, agreement on the culture or the approach, the rhetoric, especially of some people in the industry and the gun rights movement. But my biggest problem with the book is that you're kind of doing the same thing now from the other direction. When I read the book, I get a lot of demonization of gun owners, specific kinds of gun owners, and especially the industry as a whole. I mean, you kind of paint yourself in a lot of ways as the only holdout to a culture of like racism and hatred and fear. That's my overarching criticism. Maybe you can dissuade me of some of these conclusions that I've come to. I want to give you an opportunity to give your view of the book as a whole, what you were trying to accomplish with it and why you went about it in this way.
Well, boy, there's a lot in there.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's quite a lead in. So I guess I would invite you to ask questions and poke and prod as I go through
here,
and certainly interrupt me because I don't quite know where to start with all of that.
I'm sorry. That was certainly a broad view of the book as a whole.
That's okay. Sounds like you've been saving up on it. That's okay, though. So I guess I'll start with let's start with the racism thing that you brought up, because that has been,
sure.
I think some folks either that I worked with in the industry or that have just sort of read, a quick note about the book or some post or something. I argue that acceptance of racism and furthering of racism came to be a thing that was utilized by the NRA, not in a purposeful, overt way, but as a way to keep society ginned up and fearful, and politics at which I think some of these things, not specifically, but I've listened to you, and some of them you've been quite critical about the degree to which guns, gun owners, the NRA have been central in the culture wars. It's quite frustrating to me, but I know several examples of times when I was at an industry trade show or some such thing where clearly offensive, overtly racist things were, for instance, displayed on t-shirts, and thousands of people saw them at industry events and said absolutely nothing. And many people gave these generally guys that were wearing these shirts or hats or whatever, gave them high fives and like, where can I buy this thing? People at the NRA, they walked in and out of trade show booths, hundreds of them. And I don't mean to say that people in the industry are walking up and down aisles with white hoods and are overtly racist. In fact, most people in the industry that I know, I don't think they are. But much like our national politics has come to a place where it's okay with looking the other way at racist things as long as it drives your preferred political outcome, those are the things that I experienced. And I think the NRA kind of pioneered that starting 15, 18, 19 years ago, wherever you want to say. And I know you've had Tim Mack on. I don't know where the NRA kind of dove into the culture war or sort of started leading the culture war, perhaps after Columbine, given the the tapes that have been recently been discovered. But racism became a tool for the NRA, and the industry, you know, never shut it down, I guess is what I would say. I don't mean that people were racist. I just mean they were okay with using racism. I didn't have a particular aim with the book other than to explain what happened to me and try to explain to readers what the role of the firearms industry and firearms in our nation and our nation's politics. Mm-hmm. I think that it has had and continues to have an outsized role in politics. Guns are important. The Second Amendment is important. Guns are a symbol of power and of cultural connectedness, much like I explained about, you know, so many of the best parts of my life. And nefarious organizations that realize that, such as the NRA, can use those sorts of connections to do very powerful and eventually destructive things to our politics and to gun owners, I believe. My book is a plea to reasonable gun owners to say, stop letting the radicals with the mic dictate everything that is branded gun owner. I'm done with that. I don't think all gunners buy into the sort of extremism radicalization that the NRA touts. On the other hand, far too few stand up and criticize it. Now, to your point about me in the industry, it got to a point where literally nobody in the industry would ever say a critical word publicly about the NRA ever, no matter what they did. Still hardly have.
Mm-hmm. Because
why? Because you got run out, fired, castigated, chastised. We were told that all gun owners, you have to stand together with all gun owners no matter what. I know you've had David French on to talk about Kyle Rittenhouse. I believe that as David does, I believe that the verdict was legally correct. I also, like David does, believe that Rittenhouse was exceptionally morally incorrect. And I believe that the people in and around the firearms industry and the influencers who are holding Rittenhouse up as some sort of hero are creating terrible turmoil for responsible gun owners. And I think they do guns and gun owners in the nation an incredible disservice.